Hello and welcome to Let's Play Stasis. Blind. Welcome back. I'm gonna spare you guys my original beginning to this episode, where I proceeded to try to get past this airlock and then wandered all over the place not knowing what to do. I missed something in this room. This is so nasty, huh? I missed this. Well, next to the readout screens. A liquid nitrogen canister. Did I even look at these? Nothing to be seen. Canister of liquid something or other. Sorry about that. I wanted to read it. But in any case, we know what a canister of liquid nitrogen is. So we need to use this here. Oh, look, what the hell was that sound? On the airlock. Right. So you figure it would spray it on the airlock, but no. Oh, that's what caused that. I don't know if we need to back up to do this, but I did the first time. Oh, he goes over to... Oh, he just steps on that. And the way is clear. And now we're proceeding forward blind as well. I have not yet been in this room. Yeah, that's... person's alive. The creature strains at its bindings. It seems healthy, though judging by the fury in its eyes, it's far from pleased. Creature, so not human. Oh, jeez. Hybrid. It has fallen from the operating table, only to crawl around in aimless peregrination? Not sure what that means. No doubt delirious. That's me, okay. Good God. Strapped down hybrid. A frighteningly thin creature, courtesy of Kane Corporation. The room design wisely included two fluid drains. The twin valve fluid drainage system is a smart piece of design, keeping the two fluids separate. Oh, good God. I guess these people are, you know, geniuses. They're just bereft of any morality whatsoever. Conjoined hybrid fused at the spine. It appears immobile, but its heads frequently scan the room. Oh, I didn't even see that. I was looking here. Jeez. I'm still taking in everything here. So we got a terminal we can mess with. Emaciated starving organism. This body is wasted away to little more than sinew. Ew. Plastic sheeting. Spans many of the operating bays, not for modesty purposes, but to limit the splatter range. Oh, good God. Oh, we can go this way as well, apparently. Tiny hybrid. It is tiny, clinging onto life by only the finest thread. It's not a pleasant sight to watch something so small on the fine line between life and death. Withered hybrid. Both bodies barely show signs of life. Is it because this is what they've been doing to them, or because they haven't been able to care for them because of everything going on in the station? The machine attached to the drip is on and configurable, although it is far from ready to use. Splatter range. strapped-down hybrid, moving but seems to be unaware of its surroundings, or it could simply have accepted its fate. Some machinery has been shut off and tucked out of the way. Just making sure that thing's not getting away or coming towards me or something. Frighteningly thin creature, I saw that one. Good God, moisture streaks. The moisture that has saturated this laboratory is pouring down the walls. Why are we keeping this place moist? So they don't dry up and wither away? I don't know what to look at first.
Get too
close. Yeah. Gotta tell me twice. I mean, he might get close, I don't know. I don't want him to. Oh, bone mending glue. A tube of quick-drying bone adhesive. Okay, we can take that. Oh, it's the queen's milk.
This shit is straight out of the eugenics war. I taught this in my history class. All of this research will be lost. Does that mean that... this was for nothing.
For nothing.
She doesn't seem like she cares very much. She's just resigned to her what's been going on. I want to make sure I don't miss anything. Okay, just the terminal. Subject 85209 8675309. Lana. Subject's host Tara McCormick, First Lieutenant Marine Liaison. Okay, they've been giving birth to these things. Subject's observations. Rambunctious. Subject appears to have inherited her mother's powerful physical build and latent aggression. Lana has the makings of an excellent alpha female candidate. Recommendation: move Lana to a group cell as isolation appears to promote irritability. Well, they'd like to try to create a new race or something. Subject 82517, Daryl. Subject's host, Willow Brody, nurse, medical deck. Subject observations, quiet but intelligent. Attempted to pick the lock on his cell yesterday but failed to escape. Excellent puzzle-solving skills, and while not especially aggressive, has a strong build. A thinker, clearly. Subject 82522, Frederick. Subject's host, Marie Maxwell, non-crew member, caterer from Phobos. Oh, nice. I don't know why that makes her feel worse, but she's never even here. They just grabbed her as she was catering the ship, I guess. Subject observations. Subject shows little of his mother's solid frame, but is a superb hunter. Stalks and learns tactics by observing the others. Appears to be developing a strong tactical mind. These people are monsters. Holy crap. Subject. I think the human beings behind this are more monsters than these are. Subject 82599, nay. What's that about? Oh my God, what? Subject's host, Ellen Marichek, space tourist. Are you kidding me? I thought something was coming for me. I was like looking at the trying to see through the screen. I didn't realize it was because of what he read. One to watch, cunning, extraordinarily fast and dangerous, appears to prefer isolation as attempted pairings result in fatalities, takes an alpha role easily, dominates the other Novi, a definite candidate for Lana's mate. Lana's mate? Okay, yeah, he's gonna be freaking out once I exit out of here. So where are we gonna come across this Nay? Is in isolation. Appears to prefer isolation. Well, I figured he'd be saying something. So which ones are which? We don't have tags or anything. We could see which one is, you know, Lana, etc. Alright, let's through here. Oh good god, what? Strapped down creature. Is this Nay? The creature squirms in its medical restraints. Great black eyes and a sunken gray face glare with malice. Yeah. Open power cell housing. The enclosure stands empty. Mechanical utility housing awaits a replacement power cell. So, the enclosure stands empty. We want to, power these things? Is this Nay? It's not my daughter, right? This is... Surgical laser. A new remotely operated surgical model and utterly lethal in the wrong hands. It could split steel just as easily as it does flesh. Like Wolverine's claws. We got a PDA. The monitors are dark, only to be awakened when it is time for an operation. Another PDA. Life support machinery. Its pulse seems steady. The machine charts the heartbeat of the wretch strapped to the table. Anything else? So, like, about to do surgery on it and we're interrupted? Something like that? A lot of cables and stuff. An array of computer screens hangs above. A complex user rig is dormant and awaiting a trained medical technician. What would require such intense monitoring from this highly technical rig? We're trying something since this one's important. When this much data needs processing, overheating is common. These machines must use nitrogen-based coolant to keep the computer systems running smoothly. Storage drives. A freestanding data hub made for pharmaceutical companies. Mainframe computer. Surprisingly antiquated considering the surroundings, but then appearances can be deceiving. Yeah, maybe it just has a retro look to it. The computer hums with activity, processing petabytes of essential body data. The curtain marks the beginning of a private surgical bay, although close inspection reveals nothing of great interest. Glass wall. That observation wall is stained top to bottom with an unpleasant array of sticky dried substances. Anything else? I guess I could go down this way. Yeah. Just want to see if he has anything to say about any of this stuff before I head down and look at this and the PDAs. And I'm running here instead. So wait. I can't go that way? I can't go that way.
Don't go any further. I'm warning you now.
Oh yeah?
Well,
or what?
How could you do this?
I do with my children as I see fit.
Doesn't answer my question.
Barak.
Spare me the pity of the righteous. Your daughter owes her life to me.
That is
what
her daughter?
You know about Rebecca?
ARG was good on this ship, Mr. Barachek. Cancer, HIV, maybe Ola. I eliminated them all.
Is that true?
Her life is mine to do it as I choose.
No. No, it isn't.
Yes, I know about everything, Johnny Boy. I know about your daughter. And all about your wife.
Oh, God.
You are accountable.
Jammed his signal, John. You need to hurry. We're close.
I'm accountable. How am I accountable? Was he about to tell me something that I should know that she didn't want me to know? So this isn't Rebecca. I'm gonna look at this poor creature last. Oh, I can't look at the life support one? Well, check out the PDA then, I don't know. Dr. Malin's PDA. January 1st. They fear the unknown, the alien, the impossible. The new year turns. The wheel turns, and the Groomlake continues. That's my heartbeat. The wheel turns, and the Groomlake continues to lead the vanguard of scientific discovery for all of humankind. Yet I feel dissatisfied. Even as the peons who work under me celebrate the new year, I wonder why. Why would you celebrate such an asinine concept as an outdated Gregorian calendar on a ship that's currently swimming through the depths of space? The reason is clear. Comfort. They fear the unknown, the alien, the impossible. I do not. I embrace the unforgiving cosmos with open arms. The problem with the research we do is the humans doing it, constrained as they are by conscious remorse, and sometimes even fear. We try to grasp the infinite and give it a framework that ill fits its cosmic splendor. This is my 10th year as Special Projects Director for Kane Corporation. Despite my discoveries and quests for knowledge, I'm held back at every turn by paperwork, moralizing scientists, and that group of degenerate toadies that I sit on the board with. If I were rid of them, then my word would be God. My word. Not the word of a corporation. Still, they have their uses. The research is funded by Kane, and the Groomlake is kept running by the money and personnel they provide. But the time will come when all this changes. You mark my words. I just want to see, because that title did not match. It was further down, though. March 19th. Dr. Backman's tendencies are becoming harder to restrain. Oh, yeah, that guy's fucking psycho. Yeah! I'm going to go back and read the titles first. March 19th. I'm inundated with emails from all departments about inconsistencies with storage and contaminated samples. This grand masquerade is sometimes more tedious than it's actually worth. Worst of all was Dr. Way and that technician, Miss Callister, is it? I'd normally make short work of such troublemakers, but it hardly seems worthwhile. Troublemakers must be allowed to make trouble, because if they disappear, that legitimizes their claims, and somebody will always take up the fallen crusader's torch. Dr. Backman's tendencies are becoming harder to restrain. I'm well aware of his shortcomings. The old man is as brilliant as he is deranged, yet manages to go about his work with a sociopathic glee. He's useful to have around. He has requested more bodies for seed, specifically more women who are recently pregnant. That is problematic, as we have very few such women on board, and imports are not easy to come by. We may have to play this one under the radar. May 20th, the importance of seed. That fool, Dr. Gray, complained yet again about his beloved insects becoming more aggressive as a result of the power outages. So what? Let them spill out onto the decks, as far as I'm concerned. The importance of seed outranks the hydroponics project work by 1,000 to 1. I do like playing chess with Dr. Gray, of course. I win every time, a little fact that he's unlikely to tell anyone, although he does seem quite happy to contact anyone who's interested with the opinion that he'd be the next best candidate for my job. Sebastian, you would not, could not, handle what I do. If you believe otherwise, then you're as great a fool as I imagine you to be. When a day that I oversee comes, your rotting corpse will be under my feet, and I will laugh. July 4th, recreating her dead lover in the form of a hybrid? Dr. Williams is still under the delusion that I don't know about her personal research. Officially, it's illegal for staff to conduct their own research, but this is interesting. Recreating her dead lover in the form of a hybrid? How fascinating. If it works, I'll make use of it. If it doesn't, then it'll burn with the rest of the rejects. The woman is obsessed, and I know that DeSantos is playing no small part in feeding her delusions. I know her secret research won't cause me any problems, or I would never have allowed her on Project Seed. So this was what she really did? October 23rd. He'll keep the fungus alive. So it seems contaminated waste from the corpse disposal overspill is contaminating the ship. It's causing fungal growths, or so my various drones tell me. The fungus is a riveting proposition, though. While I'm angry at Dr. Backman for terminating more subjects than strictly necessary, these unintended side effects are fascinating. I intimated as much to Dr. Gray, and of course stroked his ego with hints at promotion and glory. He'll keep the fungus alive. The engineers want it destroyed, but I'm sure we can delay that. This experiment is becoming more engaging by the day, and I haven't even had to lift a finger. So while they clog up my inbox with demands and Rome burns, I plan to play the violin. We're more than secure here anyway, and this has a certain inevitability about it. I must record the daily developments as the experiment grows. So this is where the fungus came from, guys. Sheesh. And they thought it was in the food. And then there's the violent tendencies. So I wonder if you're going to hear about that here as well. November 30th. It is as I foresaw. Panic, destruction, and mayhem. And yet Seed continues apace. Once the fervor and the flame dies down, we'll sweep the decks of detritus and repurpose all of it for my beautiful hybrid creations. No more growing plants for the good of mankind. God is no longer in the machine, my friends. I am God. Nice. October 25th. My beautiful children have excelled themselves. They kill. They learn. They adapt. A primal species without any of the trappings of morality. Oh, much like you then. It's their time now. They almost came to be once, many years ago, but were snuffed out by humanity, afraid of its natural successors. This systematic extermination was given a name, the Eugenics Wars. So this is what it was, right? Someone created a new species. The public knew it as corporate warfare. In truth, it was a coordinated genocide. Humanity wasn't ready for Professor Gurren's astounding discovery and sought to destroy it. His work was not perfect, of course. That's where I came in. I spent most of my life as part of Kane, trying to access Professor Gurren's original work. Old Man Kane pushed me to the top because we shared an ideal, the utilization of science for the perfection of humanity. Where we differed was the methods by which this was to be achieved. Not that he had much more to say after I held that pillow to his face as he lay in his hospital bed. All for a higher purpose. Really? So the Eugenics Wars, a coordinated genocide. And then he killed Mr. Kane. Creation of our species from raw subjects will become impossible now that the crew are dead, dying, or unclean, but that's hardly an issue. Any subjects who are flawed or imperfect have been turned into the fertilizer that will nurture the perfection of the surviving race. Now the challenge is moving the Groomlake out of range of any other ships. No one can be allowed to escape this ship alive. Any good, strong survivors will become members of the new race. I am their creator. I control. I transcend. Well, what happens when they run out of food? Will they be coming for you? So no emails. This is the final entry. February 2nd. DeSantos. I am so very disappointed in you. A distress signal? I thought we were of one mind here in Seed. I'll castrate and destroy you for this betrayal. Your flawed body is hardly worthy of becoming one of my children, but for now I must turn off this accursed signal. You cannot hide from me, Marvin, you drug-peddling little... Wow. We are learning quite a lot here. So I hit this and he goes around. He'll run past this way. Hold on, I want to see if we can actually look at this thing. We can't. Huh. Monitors. Alright, let's read this PDA then. Weird pathing here. That's a dead space we can't walk past. Get it? Dead space. No pun intended until the end anyway. Robert Lincoln. Right. I've barely heard about this Robert Lincoln. I forget who he was. July 23rd. I've been reassigned to investigate the disappearance and murder of two scientists in the employ of Dr. Malin. A strange matter, to be sure. I've been observing the movements of some of these eggheads, and I can't say I'm too impressed. So he's an investigator. Or security, or something. Doesn't anybody around here record their comings or goings, or make any notes? There is no traditional organization in this department whatsoever. Project Seed answers to nobody, this I know, but I thought these scientific types always made notes. Not that I care about admin, but I very much care about finding out who's selling weapons-grade secrets. Industrial secrets are a matter of life and death, especially death, in this case. My investigation will be thorough, and no stone will be left unturned. The staff here are strange, and in fact, I'd say lots of them are crazy. But I couldn't care about that. I just want names and answers. I believe it was DeSantos who was selling the trade secrets. August 8th. I got this job because I get things done. Not because of my warm and caring personality. At the moment, people are taking umbrage to my investigation, but security is a constant and essential part of shipboard life, especially when we're talking about industrial espionage. I'm not sure where the two missing scientists are, but it seems, based on the modified records I've found, that they were killed and ejected into space. Any other man would assume that these two were the criminals, but I don't buy that. As far as suspects go, I've ruled out Charlotte Williams and Marvin DeSantos. Charlotte because he doesn't know where she is half the time, and DeSantos because he's just a smirking shit for brains. DeSantos, I said, right? I'm confident that he's involved in drug selling, and I will give him this. He is cautious and acts like he's a real ladies' man, but I know the truth. I've seen him rejected repeatedly at the bar. Burn. Okay, so obviously this man was caught, probably killed, maybe tortured first and operated on, but they've got his PDA. September 3rd. There are few men in this world who will do what has to be done. So that's why I read that first, because it's not here in the beginning. The subject line doesn't always appear. If that's what it is. September 23rd. Since July, I've had to operate under the pretense that I'm an assistant. It's lucky that in my career I've had some emergency room experience. The only other person who knows about my true purpose here is Dr. Malin. He's been encouraging. He constantly supplies me with information that I require for my investigation, and at times is a little over-helpful. Still, he seems honest enough. What? For the record, I'm well aware of the kind of man Dr. Malin is. I've seen his experiments with my own eyes. I've seen what happens when the bodies are disposed of, and the burning fires of the furnaces. But he does what's required to justify the means. There are few men in this world who will do what has to be done. For that, I admire him. Are you kidding me? Okay, either there's something wrong with you, or he's pulling the wool over your eyes. Is that the phrase? Pulling the wool over my eyes? He told me to watch over Dr. Williams' experiments. It seems they're unofficial, although I prepared a report to Kane to have her removed from her position. Dr. Malin immediately overrode my request. I respect him, but to be honest, I don't like having my authority overruled. November 12th. Backman, of all people, was sniffing around yesterday. It seems the old psychopath has suddenly become curious. I asked Dr. Mallon for further instructions, and he told me to incapacitate the old man. This I did. A shame I had to break the old guy's kneecaps. Honestly, I was hoping to slit his throat, but Dr. Mallon insisted that he remain alive. Alive and in pain, yet unable to move. I'm revising my earlier opinion of that DeSantos character. I still think he's a pathetic little shit, but I now believe he was partly responsible for some of the stolen information. There you go, you're onto something now. He strikes me as an amateur put up to this by an outside agent. I'll deal with DeSantos soon, but first I've got to monitor his movements. Make one move, pal, and I'll have you. December 17th. Dr. Mallon has earmarked me for one of his experiments. I know this because when I attempted to leave the ship to report to Kane Corp, I discovered that my access was restricted and blocked. I came back to my quarters and found Mallon waiting there. He was waiting with two of those hellish creatures that he's created. I'm not squeamish, but those things make me nauseous. I'm currently awaiting what he calls processing. I suppose at this stage I should make peace with God. I've killed many men in my life, but I'll never say that I feel remorse for it. And I won't give Dr. Mallon the satisfaction of hearing me pray for mercy. He killed many men. What'd he kill? DeSantos? My last notes on this affair. Or did he kill the other guy? The psycho, the old guy. Bachman. My last notes on this affair are that Dr. Mallon himself is at the heart of the events on board the ship. I was blind to it. I refused to believe that he was capable of creating such devastation. I always thought that scientists like control, but Mallon breaks all the rules as far as science is concerned. The leaked information, the fungal growth, the missing scientists. I'm beginning to suspect he even knew that DeSantos was actually selling intelligence and may have fed him the information to sell. Yup. To what end, I don't know. I suspect it was because DeSantos kept Bachman drugged to the eyeballs with whatever powerful stimulants he happened to have, so Bachman could continue his work. I can hear the machines being turned on. I welcome my fate. At least I know that I did my job for Crane Corporation. Damn, what?